Good afternoon from Crowfield Plantation in Goose Creek, South Carolina. We're taking a little break today from our visits in downtown Charleston to look at one of the properties outside of the historic community of Charleston, what we think of as now as the suburban areas to the inland side of the old city. This is in Berkeley County, South Carolina. I have been a proud resident of Goose Creek and Berkeley County now for 33 years. And my first exposure to Crowfield Plantation, which will be our main topic today, was when I first played golf. And what we're now looking at here is the 18th fairway in the distance. But what I want you to look at a little bit more closely in the distance is a row of oak trees, all lined up straight. Very old trees that date back 290 years, laid out on a road that connected the plantation of Crowfield to an old road that connected Goose Creek to Dorchester, called the Old Dorchester Road. And in front of us, a beautiful pond. And while it might be kind of difficult to see the exact symmetry here, this is a perfectly circular pond carved out of the wilderness to be on the southern border of an estate that became known as one of the most opulent plantations in all of America. So our trip today is going to be through the grounds of the old plantation. And it's technically referred to as the ruins of Crowfield because it has not been a real plantation in quite some time. And in the distance, you can see the brick remains of the old plantation house. And we'll be wandering that direction here very shortly. But for now, my introduction. My name is David Romine, and I am one of the history guys with Bulldog Tours. I started giving tours in historic Charleston in 1980 and have been giving them off and on for, I guess, 40 years now. About 30 of those years, I was a high school teacher here in Berkeley County. And during that time, I still gave some of the tours in downtown Charleston, but after retiring, I have really gotten back into giving walking tours in downtown Charleston and just love it. So I'm always, looking out for the history, looking for new stories here. And this is actually a very old story. And to understand Crowfield, we have to take a look at the Middleton family. Now, when you hear the name Middleton, if you're a visitor to Charleston, what you're usually going to be seeing is Middleton Place and Gardens. And it is a spectacular estate on the Ashley River, west of the city of Charleston, that was established by Henry Middleton back in 1741. And one of our tour guides, Lisa, did a fantastic job of giving an overview of Middleton Place not too long ago, just a few weeks ago. Now, Henry was actually the younger brother of a man named William Middleton. And my story today is going to be focusing more on William. And the overriding theme is the Goose Creek Man. Now, Goose Creek, while it now is just suburban, at one time, it was a concentration of some of the wealthiest plantations in all of America. And the Goose Creek men were mostly of Barbadian stock. And here's one of the old connections to historic Charleston. The city and the colony were established by settlers who came from Britain back in 1670. And it was a proprietary colony owned by 8 men who had been very loyal to the family of King Charles II. So Charles granted them a huge tract of land known as Carolina. And these men were essentially just looking to make a profit off of their investment. So their idea was to create a new society here in Carolina, and it was based on the idea of a new landed gentry. They were going to model their lives after the lives of the nobility in England, and while some rugged settlers came and carved their lives out of this wilderness, the Goose Creek men, those who came from Barbados, were already very wealthy. They'd made quite a bit of money in Barbados. In a lot of cases, they were the second and third sons of Barbadian planters, and they were looking to expand their wealth by developing this land in Carolina. And the proprietors had made it very clear. The people who could come with the most enslaved workers would get the largest land grants. So starting in the 1670s, land grants were given to the Goose Creek men, the Barbadians, all along the banks of a tributary of the Cooper River. Now, the first of the Middletons, those you don't hear about too much, Edward and Arthur were brothers who came into Charleston in 1679. And they were granted land along the banks of the Goose Creek. And Arthur developed what is now Otranto Plantation and then died shortly thereafter, died in 1685. His younger brother Edward was given a tract of land on the other side of Goose Creek, which he developed a plantation known as the Oaks. Planted the oak trees that are still standing there in 1681, the same year that his little boy Arthur was born, named for his uncle. And at that stage, rice plantations started developing along both sides of Goose Creek. Now, Arthur became a very powerful member of the colonial government. And one of the characteristics of the Goose Creek men, these men of Barbadian stock, was that they opposed the rule of the proprietors. And they were leaders of a revolt, which eventually took the power away from the Lord's proprietors. And they asked the King of England to make this a royal colony. And Arthur was right in the middle of all that controversy. And in 1729, we had our first royal governor. Arthur stepped to the side. And at that point, a whole new phase started, which increased the wealth, a lot more trade with England. And that's when this area became filthy rich. And on all accounts, the wealthiest men in all of British North America lived not just in the Carolina Lowcountry, but along the banks of Goose Creek. Now, Arthur had a son, a young fellow named William, who was his oldest son. At the age of 19, William was granted 1,500 acres on the far stretches of the headwaters of Goose Creek, mostly swamp fingers that kind of fed into Goose Creek, but a lot of arable land, land that was going to be really good. But at that point, for the most part, we were just looking at really, really rugged territory that had to be carved up. Now, Arthur, being of Barbadian stock, also of a kind of British nobility, decided that he was going, in this case we're talking about William. William decided he was going to create an estate that would be better than any other in the Lowcountry, maybe even in all of North America. And at that time in Britain, the stylish gardens were considered formal gardens, landscaped. Now, Henry later did the same thing in a place called Middleton. And I will show you a picture from the brochure from Middleton Place. As you can see, beautiful terraces. For those of y'all who have been to Middleton, it is really a spectacular estate. And notice the terraces, butterfly lakes, and they do advertise as the oldest formal landscape garden in America. And they can claim that right as long as they don't include Crowfield. Because before there was a Middleton, there was a Crowfield plantation, which used a lot of the same designs, methods, you know, formal symmetry that we later saw in Middleton. So we don't hear too much about William, though. Everybody knows about Henry that's been to Middleton Place. And Henry ended up becoming a very prominent member of colonial society and was also a revolutionary leader. He was the second president of the First Continental Congress. His son, Arthur Middleton, was a signer of the Declaration of Independence. Two of his daughters married signers of the Declaration of Independence and U.S. Constitution. So a very, very prominent family that gained a tremendous wealth. Now, for William, as he gained possession of this land, for the most part, it had gentle hills. You're in the Lowcountry, so it's not a lot of steep hills here. But his ambition was to level out a long stretch, carve out an area that he could create a formal garden by moving tons of earth, creating fish ponds, reflection ponds, and then eventually building a mansion that rivaled pretty much every other mansion in the Lowcountry. And here's what's left of Crowfield Plantation's original plantation house. You can see not too much left anymore. Well, you just have to imagine, back in the 1730s, 1740s, this was the grandest palace in all of the Lowcountry. And at that point, it stood three stories tall with 12 rooms and a full basement. As you can see, somewhat of the basement windows here on the bottom level. And facing the south, as we've talked about earlier, you had the circular pond, a trail that went 1 mile to the road to Dorchester. The house itself had two flankers. So on each side, you had separate buildings known as dependencies. One is a kitchen house and one is a carriage house and stable. And those dependencies are long gone. But connecting the dependencies to to this main house, you had brick walls that shielded the view, or as we say in Charleston, screened the view of the gardens beyond. And the whole approach of formal gardens like this was to make it a mystical visit. A lot of surprises. So as you came across the main highway, past the Moon Pond, as it's called, that beautiful circular pond, you come up to the gate without having any idea what lies on the other side. And as we will see tomorrow, there was a large expanse of formal gardens that stretched out probably about another 2 blocks from where we're now standing. Now, the ugly side. If you want to get into the real history of Charleston, you can never escape the fact that all the wealth, all the opulence, the lives of these very prominent men was based on the use of enslaved labor. Not only did these men use slaves, they encouraged it, and for them it was just a part of natural order, a part of God's plan that some people should be the rulers of great estates and others should be bound to the land. Now the bricks that you're looking at were made on Crowfield Plantation. You can see a very light colored clay used for these bricks. That's all native clay. These were handmade bricks. And what I think is probably one of the most poignant aspects of looking at this old estate is when you get a little bit closer, you start seeing some of the impressions. I'll zoom right in on three fingerprints. Three impressions. The method of making bricks back in those days was to put the clay in cast, lay the wet bricks on large boards in the sunshine, let the sun dry the bricks until they would be firm enough to be put into the kiln to be cured. But in the process, the bricks had to be turned occasionally. And since the bricks were still a little bit wet at the time they were being turned, sometimes the impressions of fingers and thumbs were left behind. So what you're now seeing are the impressions of human beings who lived 290 years ago. Keeping in mind, this house was completed in 1730, older than Drayton Hall Plantation. And one of the things that I've become obsessed over, it's almost like looking for four-leaf clovers, is just to start looking through these bricks and seeing those impressions of fingers and thumbs. What I think is most poignant about these little fingerprints that I've picked out, they're so little. A lot of child labor was used in the making of bricks. Sometimes you'll see big thumbprints, sometimes little tiny fingerprints here. But it brings home a very central fact. This has been an African-American community since the very beginning. These enslaved Africans who were forced to come to the New World did live a life on this land and far outnumbered the white people in Goose Creek. And within the restrictions of living in bondage, they were able to eke out an existence in this wilderness and live the best life that they could, even though they lived among the harshest conditions of all enslaved people in the world. That was also the legacy of the Goose Creek men. When they came from Barbados and their ancestors came from Barbados, they also brought with them a slave code that was one of the most harsh codes for trying to maintain control, trying to maintain power. And that meant a lot of physical and mental abuse for those that were not subservient. So as far as why these men from Africa and women and children did all of this work, it was out of fear more than anything else. Now that's always been a very hard thing to reckon with. And as a tour guide in Charleston, sometimes it's a bit of a struggle to take appreciation in some of the achievements of this time in history, considering it was built on the shoulders of enslaved people. But putting that to the side, from an anthropological point of view, it's interesting to think about, what did rich people do back in those days? What did you do to show off when you had all the wealth, you never had to worry about bills, you could spend as much money as you wanted to? How did they enjoy their lives? And the best summary, as far as these Carolina planters, particularly those of Barbadian stock, was they centered their whole lives on pleasure. Their ambition in life was to do as little work as possible and to live a life of luxury and to have palaces with huge gardens where they could enjoy life. And as we take a brief look to the north side of the mansion, we were looking at the remains of the formal gardens. Now, to take note, 1740s, this is the finest plantation in the Carolina Lowcountry, but most of you have probably never heard of Crowfield. Why is this now just neglected ruins? Whereas Middleton Place is considered a show place and very well preserved. Well, William Middleton, who named this estate after Crowfield Hall in Suffolk County, England, eventually inherited that plant or that home and that estate from his great aunt when she passed away. So in 1754, he packed up his bags and left, took his family and moved back to England, never to return to the Lowcountry of South Carolina. And from that point on, just to summarize a long stretch of history, the property went through a succession of owners. For the most part, they were people who were absentee owners, because this was a very remote plantation, very difficult to get to Crowfield. And even by the time of the American Revolution, the garden was becoming overgrown, the house was being neglected. Then by the 1850s, it was even worse shape, had suffered a great fire. And then in 1886, the great earthquake of 1886, which the epicenter of that earthquake was not too far from where we're now standing, that's what eventually knocked the walls down. And that was it for Crowfield. The land was subdivided into smaller parcels that were rented out to mostly poor African Americans who were just eking out their existence in the surrounding land. But the garden itself and the house completely overgrown until the Westvaco Corporation purchased this property back in 1930 because they needed the lumber for their paper mill. And the property they decided to preserve instead of to bowl it over, because they could have come through and leveled everything here. But they had a lot of archaeologists interested in this property. And then eventually, this stretch of their wilderness, they turned into a very upscale housing development here, a nice suburban development called Crowfield Plantation. Actually, the specific area that we're in the middle of right now is the Hamlets, which is where the Crowfield Country Club is located. And over here on this side, you can see the fairway of the 17th hole. Over here on this side, we were passing the mounds that surround the 14th hole. So on both sides of Crowfield Plantation's old garden, you've got golf courses, and you've got large houses. You know, very nice homes, 3,000, 4,000 square feet of space. If any of y'all are motivated, I can put you in one of these today, but the price I give you today is only good today. But for those of you who've been shopping for a house downtown, you might be very pleased with the real estate prices in Goose Creek, South Carolina. So now what do we see? There's a green for the 14th hole. And of the very few people who know about Crowfield Plantation, usually it's the golfers that are teeing up over here, getting ready to see if they can put their ball on that green on that par three. And some probably do come over out of curiosity. Most don't. But you see the ruins of this old house, it's a little bit of a curiosity. But luckily for us, the Crowfield property owners have control over this historic estate, and they're taking care of it. And they allow archaeological digs and have had some really good research done. And they're trying to maintain it so it's not going to decay any more than what you see right now. But if you do come and see it, and it is open to the public, there's a little access off of Hamlet Drive. Just make sure that you don't go climbing up on the building. This is all kind of off limits here. And tomorrow, I'm going to take you a little bit further in, and you'll see the remains, some of the actual earthenwork mounds of the remains of their original garden. So for today, just to kind of wrap things up, what I will tell you is that before there was a Middleton Place, there was a Crowfield Plantation, and this was the ultimate during its time. So let's see if there are any comments. If anybody has any questions here, I'm great to see everybody participating. There's my old boss, Don Brown. How you doing, Don? Raymond Owens, one of my students at Berkeley High School. And Randall Johnson. Well, this is a lot of fun. This is my first broadcast as far as a live stream for Bulldog Tours. But I can tell you that I'm getting a big kick out of getting out here, and it's just nice to have something to do on these long days where we're just kind of biding our time, waiting for us to get back on the beat in downtown Charleston. I'm just happy to be able to show off one of these old stretches of real estate that most folks have never seen. So I'll sign off, but remember, this time tomorrow, 2 p.m. tomorrow, we're going to be back here, and I'm going to take you into the garden, and I'll show you some of the surprises used to delight folks like Eliza Lucas, who visited this plantation in 1742. Until then, take care, folks, and y'all be safe.